In the part of Europe just to the north where the Atlantic Ocean meets the Arctic is the Scandinavian peninsula, divided by a long range of mountains. On the western slope lies Norway. Most are so steep and stony that nothing will grow, and only 1 acre out of 30 can be farmed. Nevertheless, the land does support people, chiefly because of the current of warm water which flows along the coast, keeping the harbors clear of ice in the coldest winters. Fish come by the millions to the shallow places near the coast, where in the warm water, food is plentiful. Many Norwegians fish all the year round, and many others, like the men of the boat Kinn, are farmers who go to sea during the freezing winter months, when their farms are covered with snow. They make a living by adding what they take from the sea to what from the land. The small fishing boat Kinn is only one of the thousands which come to the fishing grounds every year for the cod, herring, haddock, and mackerel. My name is Lars Christensen, and this is my second season of fishing aboard the Kinn.
Hey, Lars!
As cabin boy of the Kinn, my job calls for me to do just about everything. Though my father is the captain, I take my orders from everyone aboard. A good deal of the time, I'm in the galley helping the cook. The cook is probably the busiest member of the crew, while we're at sea 5 meals a day, for fishing is hard and heavy work, and it makes us all hungry. We Norwegians eat large quantities of fish, but our fishermen catch so many that a great amount is either dried or smoked, and then canned for export to other countries. When our holds are filled, we head for port again to sell our herring. This is the last catch we shall bring in this season. My countrymen are great sailors, and they put to sea in craft of all kinds. Along our coast are many aids to navigation which help guide our ships through winter snow and summer fog. Norway has been a seafaring nation for a long time. 500 years before Columbus, our ancestors, the Vikings, sailed to North America. And now our merchant fleet is the fourth in the world. Most of our large merchant vessels are always far away from Norway, carrying cargoes to and from everywhere. In a few hours, we're at Bergen, the second largest city in Norway and the biggest fishing port. Hundreds of boats are tied up at the wharves close to the fish market. The part of our catch that is not sold as food will be sent to factories to be made into oil and fertilizer. I've stopped here many times before to help unload the herring, but it's been a year since I've really seen Bergen. Because this is our last fishing trip of the season, I'll have a couple of hours to explore the city before we head for home. There are lots of things in this bustling city to impress a country boy like me. Bergen is a big railway center, and at the station are trains which bring passengers from such places as our capital, Oslo. Over the same tracks comes lumber to be made into paper and shipped abroad. There aren't any trains or even streetcars in the part of Norway where I live. When I get home, I shall tell Mother I saw the cathedral. She'll be pleased because she listens every Sunday when the cathedral choir broadcasts over the radio. Perhaps more than any other people, we Norwegians appreciate the music of our great composer Edvard Grieg, because every note is about our own forests and mountains and sea coasts. With its crowded streets, Bergen is certainly different from the little town I live near. The shops sell things from all over Norway and from foreign countries. England, France, the United States, and even China. I think I shall buy something to remind me of Bergen, just as tourists do. From Bergen, it's taken us all night to get to our village of Floro. It's good to see those docks again after 4 months away. This is an important day for us. From now on, we shall no longer be fishermen, but we'll take up our regular lives as farmers for the rest of the year. Though all of us aboard the quay are neighbors, we won't be seeing much of each other till the harvest is in. Summer in Norway is so short that there'll be something to do on each farm just about every minute, and mighty little time for visiting. There are very few roads in my part of Norway because the steep mountains make it cost too much to build them. But it's easy to get from one place to another by way of the fjords. The fjords are long arms of the ocean reaching way into the mountains. They were formed ages ago when the whole land was covered with ice. Pushing down to the sea, the ice scooped out deep valleys. Then when it melted, the sea flowed in. On its way, the ice carved little shelves of land along the mountainsides, almost the only places in my part of Norway level enough for farming. My father's farm is on a sloping patch at the foot of a mountain. Some of our buildings are 200 years old, but they have been kept in good shape, and we have improvements like electricity and a telephone. Back home, they know we are coming. Mother is preparing a big dinner. My little sister, Kari, is helping her. And most likely, my kid brother, Eric, has been put to work, too. My older sister will be setting the table. Just about now, our neighbor, Mrs. Torkelson, will be calling up to say she's seen us coming around the bend. In Norway, we don't kiss, even if we haven't seen each other for a long time. Instead, we shake hands and give one another a good hug. That means just as much. Mother's prepared a fine dinner. It's my favorite dish, beef and mutton with potato dumplings. food on the Keen was good, but not as good as this. In spite of my travels, Inger doesn't think I look much more grown up. Now the dishes are done, Kari wants to show me what's happened on the farm since I've been away. Last winter's ice and snow curled those old shingles. They'll have to be replaced. After being away so long, I must be introduced to the newest kid. During the next 3 or 4 months, my family will have to raise enough food to feed ourselves and our animals throughout the entire year. Because Norway lies in a high northern latitude, our growing season is short. But for the same reason, our days are very long and crops grow quickly. Signs of spring mean that the growing season is about to begin. Heavy spring rains have left the ground soggy underfoot. It will take a lot of sunshine before the soil will be dry enough for plowing. As is usual in late spring, the streams are overflowing with water from snow melting in the mountains above. The power of falling water is valuable to Norway, where my people call it white coal, because it is used instead of black coal to produce our electricity. On the farm, we use water power to drive our sawmills. From pine and spruce logs cut in the forest behind our farm, my father and I make new shingles to replace the damaged ones on the barn roof. My father can make almost anything out of wood, from a house to a pair of skis. The peaks of the mountains near us are white at this season, and even now, in late April, there's enough snow for skiing just a short climb from home. We all enjoy swooping down the mountainside, but to us, skiing isn't just a sport as it is in some countries. It's the only way we can get about when the snow comes up to the roof of our house. All of us learned to ski when we were little children. Even so, we're not always perfect. The last skiing before the summer work begins somehow seems the best of all. As soon as the sun has dried out the earth, farming begins in earnest. One little horse does all the heavy work, and he'll be kept busy all day long until every bit of land is ready for planting. We have to plant what grows best in our climate, but by planting a different crop each year, we get the most out of the land. When he's finished plowing, my father has us put potatoes in the field where we planted oats last year. To help keep the soil rich, my father uses fertilizer made from fish. Twice a day in the morning and in the evening, Inger milks our 3 cows. Meanwhile, as the eldest son, I help my father with his work. People like us who live on farms know how to make clothing and lots of the things city people buy in stores. We can fix things too. Salmon fishing will soon begin in the fjord, and I am teaching Eric to mend the nets. Besides everything else she does, my sister Inger takes Kari and Eric to their school. For in my part of the country, children are expected this summer to help on the farm. By boat, the trip takes only a few minutes. But if they went overland around the head of the fjord, it would take them several hours. Inger and I have finished school because in country villages like Fluro, school runs only through the 6th grade. But next year, I'm going away to high school. Besides the usual lessons, everyone in the school learns the history and geography of Scandinavia and about the people in other countries.
Let the hands for hands.
One Sunday each month, our traveling pastor makes his regular visit, and all the neighborhood families come down the fjord. Norwegians like to go to church, especially people living in the country who don't see much of one another during the summer. The men put on their best clothes, while the women and girls wear national dress. In old Norway, each section of the country had its own embroidered pattern. While we're all waiting for the service to begin, my father talks over the prospects for the summer's crops. And I try to answer everybody's questions about last winter's fishing. Our church was built out of timber cut in our own forest. Without looking at the calendar, we know that spring is over and summer is really here. Now the day comes for us to round up the farm animals. My father needs all his fields for potatoes and barley, rye and oats. And the grass on the slopes behind the farm has to be saved for hay to feed the animals next winter. So we children take the cows and sheep and goats to another grazing place. Like that day when my father and I go off to sea every January, this day marks a big change in the life of the household. Until the crops are ready for harvesting, father and mother will be the only people on the farm. On our way, we pass familiar landmarks. The goats scramble along without any trouble, but the cows have a hard time, and even the sheep have to be prodded. At last, after a good morning's climb, we come in sight of the grassland of the high slopes. In Norway, we call these mountain pastures the seters. Even in summer, the long days are cool and damp at this altitude. Though the soil is still thinner than that of my father's fields down below, there's plenty of water for the cattle to drink and sweet mountain grass and leafy bushes for them to feed on. Like the other satyrs nearby, to which the other children of the neighborhood are bringing their farm animals, our satyr has a small hut where we'll sleep. All summer long, we will have to watch for sure they don't get lost. From our high seater, it seems that we can see almost all of Norway, the mountains, the forests, and the deep fjords. And there, half a mile below us, lies our own little farm. During our summers on the Seter, we look forward each week to Saturday night, when all our friends who can get away from farm work or tending herds gather at one of the huts for a good time. Because it's summer now, the sun will be shining late into the night, and we'll have many extra hours of fun. Further north, the sun never sets for over 2 months in early summer, which is why the northernmost part of the country is called the land of the midnight sun. Everyone's here, now the party can get started. All of us, young and old, share a deep love for our mountainous country. We use our land wisely, and it serves us well. And from the waters off our coast, we take a second harvest. As farmers and fishermen, my people have lived well for many generations in the Norwegian homeland.